How many of you realize that the birth of Jesus is one of the most singular, most important events in all of human history? How many of you believe that? It's amazing because we actually divide time by the birth of Jesus, B.C. and A.D., before Christ and A.D., which stands for Anno Domini, which is Latin for the year of our Lord. So obviously it was a very significant event, the birth of the Lord Jesus Christ, right? If Christ hadn't been born in a manger, if he hadn't come, then he wouldn't have died on the cross. He wouldn't have been buried. He wouldn't have been raised from the dead. We would still be in our sins. We would still be bringing sacrificial rams and doves and lambs in order to cover our sins. Now, what we do know is that the true Christmas story has very little to do with Santa Claus and chestnuts roasting on an open fire and snowball fights and romantic Christmas movies. Has very little to do with that. But the true Christmas story really began in the heart of God, didn't it? Amen. Began in God's heart. And the scripture says this about Jesus. In Revelation chapter 13 and verse number 8, the scripture calls Jesus the Lamb that was slain from the foundation of the world. Even as God was creating the earth, he knew by his foreknowledge that mankind would sin, that man would fall away from that place of innocence. And so God planned all along to send his only son to die on the cross as the perfect lamb. So it was all in the plan of God from the very beginning. You see, God had been planning, preparing, revealing, coordinating everything in the background so that at the exact right moment, at the perfect time, he would send forth his son. And I love Galatians chapter 4 and verse number 4. This is what the word says. It says, but when the fullness of the time had come, God sent forth his son, born of a woman, born under the law. And so for us that day, you know, and I'm sure for those in that day, it seemed like an ordinary day, right? It just seemed like another day in history. But that was the day that God had planned all along, that he would send forth his son at that moment. And it was really all about God's love. It was about God's grace. It was God beginning his great rescue mission. And the beauty of all of this is that God revealed through his prophets so many details of the Savior's birth. Now, here's the thing, that to bring all of those details together and cause all of those prophetic details to make a narrative that fulfills exactly every prophecy is absolutely astounding. And so you want to know what that tells us, church? It tells us that God is in control of everything. Come on, tell your neighbor, God is in control of everything. He's in control of the end of the earth. He's in control of this age. Come on, somebody. Can we give the Lord a hand of praise today? Because God is in control. Amen. And so as we prepare for the coming of Christ, because how many of you know he's coming again? Come on. He came once, and how many of you know he's going to come again? So as we prepare for the coming of Christ, we've got to listen to the prophet's message, first of all. And the prophet's message was this, that God meticulously prepared to save humanity. So this morning we're going to look at some of the things that the prophet said about Christ and his birth. Now, how many of you realize that the Bible has a fondness for the number 7, right? 7 is a powerful and important number in the Bible. God created the earth in how many days? 7 days. And Joshua and his men marched around the wall of Jericho for 7 days. And on the 7th time, how many times did they march? 7 times, right? The book of Revelation features 7 letters written by Jesus to 7 churches. As well, there are 7 seals, 7 bowls, 7 trumpets. So all the way through the Bible, you see this number 7. And it has the idea of being a perfect number. Number 7 is the perfect number. And I don't know if that's how dice number. Anyway, we'll leave all that alone. Yeah, I'll leave the dice aside. All right. Anyway, but how many of you realize that Matthew employs the number 7 in his gospel in the first 4 chapters as he describes the birth of Jesus, in the period of Jesus' life before Jesus began to preach. He actually cites in that book of Matthew, he cites seven prophecies and their Old Testament fulfillments. And I want to touch on them really quickly today, one by one, all right? And so let's take a look at these different prophecies this morning. We're looking at Christmas through the cast of Christmas, which was the Old Testament prophets, first of all. And so Isaiah, he saw that that the child Jesus was going to be born of a virgin. The scripture says this, Isaiah 7:14, therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign that behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel. Now, I'll tell you, Isaiah may not have understood everything about it. He may not have known that it was going to be a young girl by the name of Mary who was engaged to a guy by the name of Joseph. He may not have known the exact time, but you see, by faith, Isaiah looked forward and he saw this miraculous thing that God was going to do that was going to be a sign for his people, and that a woman was going to give birth having never known a man. And then he realized that this was a special child that would be part human, no, not part human, fully human and fully God, right? And they would call his name Emmanuel. Now, how many of you know that Jesus is the perfect mediator between God and man? The Bible says this, that there's only one mediator between God and man, one go-between between God and man, and that's Jesus. And he's absolutely perfect for that. Why? Because he's fully God. Who's his father? Our Heavenly Father. Who's his mother? Mary, who was completely human, right? Amen. So he's the perfect one to take the hand of humanity and the hand of God and bring them together. Come on, can we give a big hand for Jesus today? The second miracle is this, that his birth was in the city of Bethlehem. I know y'all know that song, "Oh, Little Town of Bethlehem," right? And Micah the prophet saw this years before it happened. It says, "But you, Bethlehem Ephrathah, though you are little among the thousands of Judah, out of you shall come forth to me the one to be ruler in Israel, whose goings forth are from old, from everlasting." Now, this is the amazing thing. Mary and Joseph did not even live in Bethlehem, but they were traveling there because of the census that was going to be called. You see, God knew all of this was going to happen, and he had to arrange every single little detail. And it was in that little town of Bethlehem where Jesus was born. How many of you know that Bethlehem means house of bread? The word Bethlehem means house of bread. It is fitting, my friend, that the one who said, "I am the bread of life," would be born in the house of bread. Come on. How many of you know that God has all these details down? The third thing Matthew writes about is the flight to Egypt and the consequent return, right? And so if you recall, when the wise men came to Herod, you may remember the story. They came to Herod and said, "We're looking for this one whose star we saw, especially special ruler's been born." And so Herod, being wicked, decided to destroy all of the innocent children in that area under age 2. But you see, God warned Joseph in a dream, right? And so Joseph took Jesus and Mary and went down to Egypt. And then later God told him, now it's safe to come back. And that fulfills Hosea chapter 11 and verse number 1, where it says, "And out of Egypt I called my son." How many of you know that God planned all of these things? Amen. The fourth thing that Matthew writes about is the slaughter of the innocents in Bethlehem. Now, I'll tell you, God did not cause that event to happen. How many of you realize that? God didn't cause that to happen. No. Good things come from the heart of God. But you see, God knew that in the evil heart of Herod that he would try to destroy the baby Jesus. And so he had all those children killed. And Jeremiah saw this hundreds of years before it even happened and wrote about it in Jeremiah 31 and verse 15. It says, "A voice was heard in Ramah, lamentation and bitter weeping, Rachel weeping for her children, refusing to be comforted for her children because they are no more." How many of you are hanging with me today? All right, we're going to get to the application in a minute. All right. The fifth thing Matthew wrote of was the home base of Nazareth. You see, Nazareth was a place where people despised you if you came from there. In fact, in the New Testament, one guy said, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" And so Jesus was actually called a Nazarene. And it's very significant because the scripture tells us in Isaiah chapter 53 that he was despised and rejected of men, having great significance because Nazareth was despised, Jesus was despised. And so in type, Jesus fulfilled that prophecy in a powerful way. The sixth thing that Matthew writes was that there was a fulfillment of prophecy in the ministry of the forerunner, John the Baptist. How many ever heard of him? All right. Amen. John the Baptist. He was a guy that was the last Old Testament prophet. And Isaiah wrote of him in Isaiah chapter 40. He said, "The voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make straight in the desert a highway for our God." And so you see, John the Baptist was the last of the Old Testament prophets. And his message was a simple one. His message was for those who heard his voice to repent, because the Messiah, the great anointed one, was coming. And he identified himself as fulfilling this prophecy. He said, "I'm the voice of one that's crying in the wilderness." And he also clearly identified who Jesus was. Amen. He said, "I'm not even worthy to stoop down and untie his sandals." And one day as Jesus was coming, he said, "Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." Come on. Are you grateful for Jesus today who took away our sin? Amen. And then the seventh thing that Matthew writes about was that Jesus' ministry would begin in the northern regions of Israel. In Isaiah chapter 9, he talks about the land of Zebulun and Naphtali by the way of the sea beyond the Jordan and Galilee of the Gentiles. And it goes on in the next verse there to say, "The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who dwelt in the land of the shadow of death, upon them a light has shined." And how many of you realize that Jesus' ministry began in that region up around the Sea of Galilee? That fulfilled biblical prophecy. And you see, what Matthew was trying to say was that Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God, he fulfilled prophecy seven different ways, and that's a perfect way. Come on. Come on. Can we give the Lord a big hand today? Amen. Because God fulfills prophecy. But I want you to understand that that is just the beginning. Those were just seven out of about 150 prophecies that Isaiah that Matthew could have written about. His book would have been really long had he listed every one. So he listed just seven to let you understand that Jesus is indeed the perfect Messiah. Come on. Amen. Some have counted right at 300 Old Testament prophecies that Christ has fulfilled or will fulfill in the future when he returns to earth again. And Peter Stoner, in his classic book, Science Speaks, calculated the chance of any man fulfilling these prophecies, even down to the present time, to be one in... I can't say that number, all right? 10 to the 17th power, come on. I mean, it is an absolute miracle, the prophetic things that God has done in fulfillment of prophecy. Amen. It is absolutely incredible. And there are many others that we could talk about. He rode into Jerusalem on a donkey's colt. He was betrayed by a friend by 30 pieces of silver. That money would be used to buy a potter's field. The Messiah would die a sacrificial death for us. He would die with criminals but be buried with the wealthy. He would rise from the dead. He would say certain words on the cross. They would gamble for his clothes. All these things were predicted hundreds and hundreds of years in the future. Come on. Can we give God a big hand of praise today? You say, "Pastor Bob,